Okay, so so last time we finished by defining the notion of spherical category. So we said that a spherical category is a category with a spherical structure. We said that, and the spherical structure is a pivotal structure in which the dimension of an object V according to A is equal to the dimension of its dual according to A. So this is the definition of spherical according to the book. But I said that there is an alternating definition. So I will recall that because we briefly recall this definition, a pivotal structure. On tensor category. C is spherical if exactly what I just said. All V. So that we wrote last time. And if so a tensor category is spherical if it has a spherical structure. Okay, so that we said. So I said last time, but I will not write, that we can reduce to, we only need to check that V is simple because the dimension is additive on exact sequence. So you can assume V is simple in the definition. So what I want to emphasize for now is that you can find in the literature spherical can equivalently be defined by for all x in C and for all morphism between x and x then trace of alpha is equal of trace of the dual of the morphism of alpha, where the trace without capital, where trace of alpha is equal to the left trace of associativity constraint composed with alpha. And of course, then trace of alpha star is equal to left trace AX star. because alpha star is between x star and x star. So this definition is general, is not just for this alpha, but also for alpha star, you just replace x by x star. Anyway. So this is why it is equivalent, as I said. Why this they are equivalent. These two definitions are equivalent. So there are two ways. The one way is trivial. So the first way is trivial. Just take alpha equal to the identity of x. Because then trace of alpha is equal to left trace of ax composed with the identity, so just ax, so the dime a of x and trace of alpha star will be left trace of ax, what dimension a of x star. So I can just write id here, id x star. And of course, id x star equal id x star. Okay. So this way is completely trivial. What is really non-trivial is the other way. So other way is not trivial. So to prove it, let us first reformulate the equality trace alpha equal trace of alpha star. So how? So we will reformulate that. So we know, so first, so trace of alpha is so that's okay. Left trace of AX composed with alpha, and we want that trace of alpha star is equal to the right trace of alpha composed with AX inverse. So that's this equality is equivalent to that equal to that. And this is what we will next prove to get the other way. So trace. So trace of alpha star is the left trace of AX star composed with alpha star. That's okay. Then this is equal to my some previous proposition. Some previous proposition point one. So not today, but maybe last time. Is equal to the right trace of so by some previous proposition we have something like that. Trace what was the thing? Left trace of A equal of S star with A in something in from C V V star. So this proposition. So you apply this proposition here, and so you can put the star in some star inside. So A X star compose alpha star star. Okay. Then we know that so here, so should I write? F from G star equal G star compose S star. So now you get left trace of alpha double star compose A X star star. You get that. But we proved lemma last time, what we call lemma zero. So what is lemma zero? Lemma zero, yeah, say that how so lemma zero, this is equal to so AX star equal A inverse X star so I should write Y star A. This lemma A Y star equal A Y star inverse. So that we proved last time. Okay. So next, so then we have this is equal to trace right trace of alpha double star composed with A X star star inverse. It's equal to so this was previous previous lemma zero. So by some previous lemma three. Lemma three, we did that last time. What this lemma three was about? Yeah, you can put the double star outside, and then you can commute with the inverse. So you have is equal to left right trace of alpha delta star composed with a x double star inverse. Inverse double star like that. Et x inverse double star. So I did two steps here. Okay, then this is equal to the right trace of you put alpha compose a x inverse double star. So you apply two times the composition of you apply two times this, and you get that. And this is equal to, finally, to the right trace of just alpha composed with AX inverse. You can remove the double star by zigzag relation. Zigzag. We already did that previously. So we get what we wanted to prove. So we get that this equal to this. This is what we wanted to prove. So conclusion. This equality is equivalent to this equality. Okay, so to prove the other way, we need to prove this equality. And this is the next theorem. Let C be a spherical tensor category and let X be an object, then for all morphism alpha in the Ohm space between X and X, exactly what we this is equal to this. So I should put X everywhere. Yeah, X. X. So in the proof. So in the proof, I use other notation. So I use X instead of alpha. But this is a notation of the book. And I follow this notation and I use V for X like that. V. So V. Okay. So how to prove that? So proof. What time? Proof. So we already know that. So the left trace of AX star composed with alpha is equal to that. This is what we proved here. We already know that this equal to this. If alpha equals the identity of x, then the right trace of AX inverse equal to the left trace of AX star, which is equal to the dimension A of X star. Okay, next. So next, we will first prove the statement in the semi-simple case. And then we will explain why we can deduce the non-semi-simple case from the semi-simple case. So let us first prove the result in the semi-simple case. The semi-simple case. So you take V. So now it's semi-simple. So V, it decomposes into simple object, and the number of ways this simple object appear up to isomorphism is denoted by some vector space, multiplicity space. So you have where Vi is a simple object up to isomorphism. And this is multiplicity vector space. Finite dimensional, which is finite dimensional. So you have so y tensor Vi is equal to is isomorphic to Vi plus Vi dimension of Yi times. This is the meaning of this notation with a multiplicity space. Dimension of Yi times. Okay. So V can be written like that. Now you take the morphism between V and V, X. So then the morphism V and V decompose as X, so the direct sum of Xi tensor identity of Vi by Shor lemma. By Shor's lemma. So xi, where xi is a matrix, the morphism, matrix. And by Shor lemma, because we know if they are up to isomorphism, so they are non-isomorphic if I is different from J, VI is not isomorphic to J. So the morphism between V and V, you just keep the, anyway, this is direct by Shor lemma. So this is how X decompose. Now, what about the associativity constraint? It decomposes like that. Now it's identity on the multiplicity space, and you take the associativity constraint on the simple. Okay. And this is by naturality of the associativity constraint we already mentioned previously. Right. I'm sure I mentioned that somewhere. So naturality. Additivity. By additivity of the associativity constraint. Okay, so we have that. Then you can decompose the left trace. AV composed with X. This is exactly, so you just replace the direct sum and you compose that and that. So you have identity. So you will only get that, and we have identity here, so you will only get that. So it's exactly XI tensor AVI. Okay. And this is equal to, so now we will, so this is equal to the sum over I of the trace, the matrix trace of XI, matrix trace. Because XI is not an object, this is just a matrix, linear map, time, the left trace, of that, which is the dimension of VI, times the left trace of AVI, which is the in A of VI. And so this equality, so you need to check. So so this equality is an exercise. Need to check, but it's not complicated. Next, similarly, the right trace of X composed with AV inverse is similarly equal to the right trace of the sum over I of xi tensor et vi inverse. So similarly, and this is equal to sum of trace of xi. So I should dim a of vi star. So to keep the symmetry, I will write directly here dim a of vi. Okay. So we are almost done. But we are done because this is equal to this by assumption, by sphericality. But by sphericality, dim A of Vi equal dim A of Vi star by definition of. So it's okay. So okay for the semi-simple case. Now what about the non-semi-simple case? So as usual, I will go quickly for the non-semi-simple case. Because I am not very comfortable with the non-semi-simple case. And also I am not that much interested, at least today. But for those who are interested, I think it's good to mention the non-semi-simple case. So about the general case. So consider the filtration of the object V as follow. So you start from the zero element, the object V1. So filtration is like that with inclusion, subobject, such that this quotient is not simple as for the Jordan order sequence, but it's semi-simple. In fact, is the sum of all simple subobjects of V over VI. So you make a kind of Jordan order sequence where you replace simple by semi-simple, and in fact, so this is called such a filtration. Filtration. So we don't need this notation, but okay. So remark. So it always exists. Such a filtration always exists. It is the filtration of minimal lengths such that the successive quotient are semi-simple. As I said, is as for journal order, where you replace simple by semi-simple. And this length is an invariant, is called Lowy thanks. So I just note that just for information, we will not use that. So I put parentheses because this is not important for our need now. So then what about the proof in the general case? So we have this socle filtration, and you observe that the application of A, so the VI go to VI star or X by composition keep the filtration structure. Okay. Now, from a filtration, we have a bunch of short exact sequences. As follow, VI plus one, VI plus one over VI zero. But the left trace is additive on exact sequence, etc. And so exercise deduce the general case. The general case from the semi-simple case. Okay. So this is as I said, I don't want to go into too much detail for the non-semi-simple case, but still I want to write hint, some sketch. Okay, so we have we finally prove this theorem. Which prove that the definition of spherical given here is equivalent to taking this definition, this equality. Okay. And it's good to have that because in some context is good, it's better to use one definition, and in some other context to use the other definition. But it's good to have the two definitions equivalent. Okay. So now we will recall a bit of some notion coming from action of group We call that what is the notion of transitive action, free action, and what is the G torsor for a group. Why we want to recall that? So this is very quick, because we will state a result involving. So if you have two pivotal structures, then the set of isomorphism class of pivotal structure is a G torsor with G, the monoidal automorphism of the identity functor. So I will state that without proof or as an exercise. But for that, we need to recall what is a G torsor. And a G torsor is given by a transitive free action of a group. So let's recall what is a transitive and a free action of a group. This is very quick. So definition. Let J be a group acting on a set S non-empty. This action is called transitive. Transitive if for all x and y in the set, so any two elements of the set can be connected by a one element of the group. You can go from one to the other. And it is called free if so if you have two this implies to G equal X H. For all X in S. So if the action of G, if the action by the element G or by the element H is the same for all X, then G and H must be the same element. This is what is a free action. If the action is both transitive and free, S is called a G torsor. So we will, as I said, so we will make the pause now. Pause. So we know what is a G torsor now. So exercise. Exercise. So let A prime be two pivotal structure on C. So C is a tensor category. So A prime. So it's a natural isomorphism between the identity and the double dual. Show the exercise said that to show the existence of, so that will be the transitive part, the existence of alpha in the group of monoidal automorphism of the identity functor such that A prime is equivalent to A composed with phi. So this is the transitive part. Transitive. And recall that this group is group of natural monoidal automorphism of the identity endo functor, so it's a functor on, from C to itself, endo functor. Okay. So this is a transitive part. Now what about the free part? Let you have two such elements. Such that we have that. For all for all pivotal structure. Okay. Show that these two are equivalent or equal, I'm not sure. Here, this is, so we are talking about the isomorphism class of pivotal structure. The set is a set of isomorphism class of pivotal structure, but the group is that, so I guess it should be equal. So this is a free part. Free. So in other words, as stated in the book. So it's a book that don't write all these details, that just state the following. The set of isomorphism classes of pivotal structure on C is tensor ID C torsor. Free plus transitive, the torsor. So in the book, they only write that, so it's a bit, it was a bit confusing for me, so that's why I we call all these definitions. And I detail the exercise. I put all these steps for the exercise. So that should be okay. Okay. And they also state so the set of isomorphism class of spherical structure is also a torsor for this group, but when you take only the element of order 2. So similarly, or idem, show that the set of isomorphism classes of spherical structure on C is a hot time C2 torsor. And 2 mean order less than or equal to 2 elements over the simple object. Okay, so I don't want to go into the details for that, but you can do that as an exercise. Okay, so now we finish this section about pivotal and spherical structure, and we will provide some extra property for multi-tensor category in the semi-simple case. Semi-simple multi-tensor category. So we always work on the algebraic A-closed field, B, and algebraically closed field. As I said, we will provide here in this section some important properties. The semi-simple case. In the semi-simple case. Okay, so first property is something we already mentioned. I was a bit confused at that moment, but in a multi-tensor category, you don't always have that the left dual and the right dual of an object. They are not always isomorphic, but they are isomorphic in the semi-simple case. So that is fundamental. Let's see. Be a semi-simple multi-tensor category over the field K, and let V be an object C, then the right dual of V is isomorphic to the left dual of V, which implies that V is isomorphic to its double dual. And this is really important if you want to have a pivotal structure. In fact, this property is necessary to have a pivotal structure, and we don't know whether it is sufficient. But that we know non-semi-simple example where this is not true. So if this is not true, then a fortiori, you cannot have a pivotal structure. But in the semi-simple case, we have that, and we will state later that we conjecture that they always have a pivotal structure. Okay, so how to prove that? So the proof will use what we several times mentioned, the natural adjunction isomorphism. And the proof, because it's semi-simple, we can reduce to V to be a simple object. We can assume that V is simple. So we can assume it is simple. Then to take another simple object. And we will state something related to the natural adjunction isomorphism and the Schur lemma. So note that the Ohm space between 1 and V tensor X is isomorphic to like that. You put the X on the left with the right dual. So this is a natural adjunction isomorphism. Natural adjunction isomorphism. Okay. And this is different from zero if and only if the right dual of X is isomorphic to V. This is by Schur. Schur lemma. And you can finally say if and only if you put the star on the other way, X is isomorphic to V star, because I already mentioned that you have a right dual, then you can have also a left dual. Yeah, if V is a right dual of X, then X is a left dual of V. Okay, and this is one point, and similarly, the Ohm space V tensor X 1, you have the natural adjunction isomorphism V X star now. So you have to be careful. Here you need the right dual, and here you need the left dual. And we prove that using a picture. So, same thing. This is different from zero by Schur. Again, if X star is isomorphic to V, if X is isomorphic to the left right dual of V. By Schur. Okay, so that's easy. Next, So next, we will see. So for now, we don't use the semi-simple case. Right? We use it to reduce to the simple case, but we need to use it more, because otherwise, maybe to prove something in the simple case, you can have the general case by using Jordan order sequence and some additivity. We will really use the semi-simple case now. So if, so now we will, so we will use, so the left dual means the existence of a co-evaluation map, and a co-evaluation map is a map which is which look like something like that, where x is vista. So if x is vista, then by definition, there is a non-zero. So it's important the co-evaluation map is non-zero. Co-evaluation map. Coev from one to vtensor vstar. So the home space, this home space is non-zero because you have the co-evaluation map inside. So it is of non-zero dimension. So the dimension as a space of that is non-zero. But, and here we will use a semi-simple case, a semi-simple assumption, but by semi-simplicity, the dimension k over k of the home space of that, this dimension is equal to the dimension where you put one on the right, v tensor v star one. Why that? Because this dimension is just because this, I will write it in green because it's not essential, because this dimension are exactly the number, the multiplicity of one in V tensor Vista. The multiplicity of one in the decomposition of V tensor V star. Yeah. So, but we know this one is non-zero. So this one must be non-zero because they are the same dimension. So, dimension k of that different from zero. And so then this home space is non-zero. And so But this some space is non-zero if and only if. Where is it? Here. If and only if we have x, which is isomorphic to star x, star v. But x is v star. So, thus, by above, this above here. We have X, which is V star, isomorphic to star V. And this is what we wanted to prove. And the other part is immediate. So just as I said, if X is a left dual, then of V, then V is a right dual of X, etc. So this is immediate. So this is really, really, really important. Really, really important. This is not so hard to prove. And this is false. It is false when it is not semi-simple. So above result is false without so wait, so what about okay, so what happened? What? It's okay, now the sound is working. Who is the... Okay, so it should be okay. yeah, so to see an example, see example. I will not mention the example here, but we can refer to the book 7.19.5 in the book. So it's false if it is not semi-simple. What about GLP? Okay. Now I will state the very famous open problem about pivotal structure. So, so above result Yeah, so it's not I should share my screen, okay. That was the problem. Okay, sorry about that. So so as I said, I don't know where it got. so as I said, Abel result is false without semi-simple assumption. And I cite an example in the book, but I don't mention it now. And so Abel result, it lead to a very famous conjecture. Plus to the following famous open problem. Because V isomorphic to V double star for all V is a necessary condition for the existence of a pivotal structure. So the open problem is whether there always exists a pivotal structure. So we know we have the sufficient condition, but we don't know whether it is we have a necessary condition, we don't know whether it is sufficient. So more specifically, the open problem is as follows. Open problem, very famous. So does every semi-simple tensor, but I don't put multi-tensor in the book. I don't know if there are multi-tensor counterexample, but at least for tensor, it's open. So semi-simple tensor category admit a pivotal structure. Or a spherical structure. And you can play with that. You can say, okay, does every pivotal structure spherical? Does every semi-simple tensor category with a pivotal structure also have the spherical structure, etc., etc.? So spherical implies pivotal, but so you can play with a lot of problems. So it is open also for fusion category over the complex field. In fact, it should be also open for unitary fusion category, which is even stronger, I guess. For fusion category over C. For unitary fusion category, a unitary fusion category is a pseudo-unitary over C, and then pseudo-unitary implies spherical, which implies pivotal. So if I'm not mistaken, But I will write that. But wait. But true, non-true, non-true for unitary fusion category over C. Because because unitary imply pseudo unitary, which implies spherical, imply pivotal, if I am not mistaken. So that will be proved later in the book. Pivotal. yeah. I guess. If I'm not mistaken, it is true. See later. See later in the course. So in particular, if you have a fusion category over C which is non-pivotal, then it cannot be unitary. It cannot be pseudo-unitary, but we know fusion categories which are not pseudo-unitary, but they are still pivotal. We know. Non pseudo unitary fusion category, but they are still pivotal, spherical in fact. Spherical. This is a very famous new recent paper called Non-Pseudo-Unitary Fusion Category or something like that. Okay. okay, so this is a very important problem, so that's why I want to enlighten that. There are a lot of work around this problem. And we are not sure it is true, in fact. Maybe, but maybe it's not true. In fact, I know a criterion for a fusion ring to admit no pivotal complex categorification. So I know such fusion ring. So such fusion ring, if such a fusion ring has a complex categorification, it cannot be pivotal. So there are some such fusion ring, such criterion related to the Drinfeld Center. So we will mention that later. Really later, maybe. I will have no time to mention that in this semester, maybe next semester. So if I cannot finish, I cannot cover the book properly this semester, I will continue next semester up to a complete covering, because this is really important for me. Okay. And I want to write some weaker version. Weaker version or stronger. In fact, weaker version of a problem, this depends on if the result, if the solution is positive or negative. It is weaker if it is positive, stronger if it is negative. So So it's as follow. Is there a multi-tensor category with V isomorphic to V star, double star, for all objects, but, so it's a question. I can state it as a question, but if it is non-trivial answer, it can be a weaker version of the problem. Is there a multi-tensor category where V is isomorphic to V double star for all objects, but without pivotal structure? Because the pivotal structure is more than that. That is just a necessary condition, but is it sufficient, in fact? This is exactly the question I ask here. Is it sufficient? So this question is exactly the question, is it sufficient? And this open problem is a weaker version, in some sense, of is it sufficient? We restrict to three simple tensor category. So we know V is always isomorphic to V double star, but we don't know whether they always have a pivotal structure. Okay. So we have time to state, at least state the next proposition. So the next proposition is saying what? Yes, the next proposition is also very important. It's saying that the trace, the left or right trace of the of an isomorphism between V and V double star is never zero. In particular, so in a semi-simple tensor category. In particular, the dimension is never zero. So proposition. Let's see. Be a semi-simple tensor category. Over an algebraic closed K, let V be a simple object in C and A from V, the isomorphism between V and V double star, some isomorphism, so isomorphism. Then the right trace of A and the left trace of A are different from zero. So in particular, in particular, in the pivotal case, so if above C is pivotal, then the dimension I should not write A because this is for the, I could put B for not being confused, or alpha, 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 alpha. So we, as a pivotal structure, so if f of c has a pivotal structure A, then dim A v is different from zero. So you cannot have zero object with a zero categorical dimension. Of course, in the non-semisimple case, you can have, we will see. Next time, we will prove above proposition and see non-semi-simple example where dim a v is equal to zero. So it's okay for today. And then we will talk about the Grothendieck. So we will, after that, we will prove some extra result about the Grothendieck ring in the for semi-simple tensor category. So then, we will provide extra result for the Grothendieck ring of a semi-simple tensor category. The Grothendieck ring of semi-simple tensor category. Okay. So see you next time. So we will stop here.